Welcome to the rocket profile of the Long March 2F, the way China gets astronauts into space. The entire launcher uses UDMH, which is unsymmetrical dimethylhydrazine and nitrogen tetroxide as propellant. In fact, the main engines used throughout are all the same engine, the YF-20B. Each of the four boosters has one YF-20B, and the core has four YF-20Bs. The second stage uses a single YF-20B, though this one is called the YF-22B because it doesn't gimbal, and it is accompanied by four YF-23B verniers. Each YF-20B provides 814 kilonewtons of thrust, so that is the output of each of the boosters. The boosters burn for around 2 minutes and 8 seconds, though there's some uncertainty about that number. The efficiency for the engine is 291 seconds vacuum-specific impulse. The YF-20B is similar to the Viking engines used in the early Ariane rockets, Ariane 1 through 4, as well as the Vikas engine used in Indian rockets. These are all based on a long line of Russian engines like the RD-250 on the Cyclone rocket, which also burn UDMH and N204. As mentioned, the core stage uses four of the same engines as the boosters. The only difference is the burn time, which is 166 seconds. However, while watching the Long March 2F fly, it is evident that there is not much gap between the booster separation and the first stage separation, so either the core stage is underfueled, perhaps because of the payload, or the boosters burn for longer than expected. With its four vernier engines, which are currently doing a bit of a roll oscillation there, the second stage outputs 831 kilonewtons of vacuum thrust. It also has a slightly higher vacuum-specific impulse of 298 seconds. The entire stage is designated YF-24B, while the main engine is YF-22B, and the verniers are YF-23B. The burn time for this stage is 5 minutes. Considering the size of the rocket, the upper stage has a very high thrust. There is no indication that the engine throttles, so close to the end of the stage's burn, the G-forces can exceed 5 Gs unless there is leftover fuel in the tank. The Shenzhou spacecraft itself resembles a Soyuz spacecraft because Russia sold the technology to China along with the necessary training, and the Chinese put it to use. The craft you see here, though, is neither a Soyuz nor a Shenzhou, but uncrewed Progress used as a test article. The main difference between a Shenzhou and a Soyuz is the more cylindrical orbital module in the Shenzhou replacing the spherical Soyuz orbital module. This gives the astronauts more room in space. Until Shenzhou 8, the orbital module could actually serve as an independent spacecraft, like a mini space station. Long March 2F has been launched 13 times with 13 successes, a perfect record for this particular variant of the Long March 2. 11 of those flights were with the Shenzhou spacecraft, and the other two launched a Tiangong space station in a modified fairing. The capacity to orbit of the Long March 2F is 8.4 tons. And with that, thank you for watching this rocket profile of the Long March 2F.
In the last class, we had looked at cycle analysis of air breathing engines. Now, let us look at rocket engines in the next few classes. Here, we will be trying to derive expressions for specific impulse, okay, and how mass flow rate varies through a choke nozzle, how do we get thrust, how do we get exit velocity. What are the assumptions that we make, and as a consequence of these assumptions, what do we have to deal with, okay, or what is the error of these assumptions? We will look at it a little later in the course, okay, fine. So, now let us look at rocket engines. Now, rocket engines all the three kinds of rocket engines that we discussed in the earlier classes, that is solid, liquid and hybrid, all three of them have the following, that is they have propellant storage. Then they have a thrust chamber. And lastly, a convergent divergent nozzle. In the solid rocket, both these two are in the same physical location, whereas in liquids and hybrids, all three of them are separate. But one thing common to all of them is this part, that is the nozzle part. Okay. In the nozzle, what you have is the thermal energy because of released because of chemical reactions is now converted into kinetic energy. So in the nozzle you have thermal to kinetic energy conversion, okay. And as this is common to all three kinds of rockets, we can study them exclusively, okay, and without having to pay any attention to what kind of rocket it is, whether it is a solid rocket or a liquid rocket or a hybrid rocket. So we will do that now. We will look at the convergent divergent nozzle. Now before we go there, what we are going to look at is quasi steady one dimensional analysis. That is, we are going to assume that all changes happen along the axis only. There are no changes that are happening in the radial or the azimuth direction, r and theta directions. We do not assume any changes to be happening. So all changes are happening along the axis, so it is one dimensional, which is not strictly true for a rocket engine nozzle. Okay. We will see what errors this bring about a little later. First is we are going to make this assumption. Then we are going to assume that the chamber pressure and temperature are given to us. That is, let us say if this is the rocket motor we will assume that we know chamber pressure, which is called PC, and chamber temperature TC as known. We will also take these to be stagnation quantities. That is, if you look at velocities elsewhere in the nozzle and if you look at the velocity at the entry of the nozzle, these velocities are very small compared to the velocities as you go along the nozzle. So you can take them to be stagnation conditions at the entry of the nozzle. Okay. And we are also going to assume that as I said, these are known to us firstly, and we are also going to assume that fluid is an ideal gas with constant thermodynamic properties. That is, the Cp, gamma, thermal conductivity, all these do not change as we go from this portion of the nozzle to the exit of the nozzle, okay. Then we will also assume that the flow is inviscid. That is, viscosities are very small, and we will also assume fluid flow is isentropic. Okay. So, with these assumptions, let us see what we can derive, and based on this, we will also evaluate what are the shortcomings of some of these assumptions, are these really valid, and then we will try to estimate what is the error in them, okay. Now from your basic gas dynamics, you know that for a nozzle, for a convergent divergent nozzle, I can write du by u, that is change in velocity as you move along the nozzle, is equal to okay. Now we know that if m is less than 1, what should be the dA by A if this has to fluid has to accelerate? If m is less than 1, dA by A has to be negative if fluid has to accelerate, and if m is greater than 1, dA by A has to be positive if fluid has to accelerate, okay. And we know that if at the throat, at the throat of the CD nozzle, Mach number is 1, then we call it choke nozzle. Let us now find out what is the pressure ratio. If you have PC here, what should be the PA, or what should be this ratio of PC by PA for the nozzle to be choked, okay. So let us find the critical ratio of this pressure for choking. In order to do this, we will solve the energy equation from here to here, okay, from the entry to the throat section, and I can write one dimensional energy equation as one dimensional steady state and for inviscid flow with constant thermodynamic properties. I can write the energy equation as HT plus is equal to UT, where C where C there indicates chamber conditions and T indicates throat conditions. C indicates and T indicates throat. That is, we are looking at this to be C, this to be T. Okay. Now, there is no heat addition that is taking place from here to here, okay, and the composition is the same. So, if the composition is the same, then Cp has to be the same. So, C to T, that is from chamber to throat, which means that Cp is same and there is only change in sensible enthalpy, and it also means that only there is change in enthalpy because there are no reactions that are taking place. So, if all the change from C to T is only because of sensible enthalpy change, then I can rewrite this equation as that is, I have replaced HT by CPTT and HC by CPTC. We also know that if the throat is, if the flow is choked at the throat, then at throat M is equal to 1 and therefore UT is equal to AT, that is the speed of sound, which is given by here R is nothing but R is equal to RU, universal gas constant, divided by molecular weight. Okay. Now, using all this, we can simplify this equation further and write it as because we know UT is equal to AT and AT is this. So, I can write it like this is equal to we know that Cp by Cv is equal to gamma and Cp minus Cv is equal to R. So, dividing the entire equation by Cp Tt, that is dividing by CPTT, we will get 1 plus gamma R TT divided by 2 okay. Now we know that R and CP we can get through this. So, let me write that down. This will then become 1 plus gamma into 1 by 1 minus gamma. This and this cancels out, so you get 2 is equal to Tc by Tt, or simplifying, I can write Tc by Tt is equal to gamma plus 1 by 2. Okay. From this and knowing the connection between Cp to temperatures to pressure for an isentropic flow, I can write Pc by Pt as equal to so now we can get the critical ratio that is required for choking, okay. And if you substitute for gamma equal to 1.2, which is usually the value of gamma for burned gases, you get Pc by Pt to be 1.7. That is, if the chamber ratio to the exit pressure or the pressure outside is greater than this, then the nozzle will be choked, okay. So for any pressure ratio Pc by, or for any pressure ratio that is from Pc to ambient wherein it is greater than or equal to 1.7, then the flow at flow is called choke flow. As I had said in the previous class, the advantage of choke flow is now it becomes independent of downstream conditions and it is only a function of upstream conditions, okay. So let us see how we can use this to calculate what is the mass flow rate through a choke nozzle, okay. We have calculated what is the ratio that is required for the flow to be choked. Let us now calculate what is the mass flow rate through a choke nozzle. Now we know that m dot, which is the mass flow rate, is given by rho t At into Vt, where t, as I said earlier, indicates throat conditions. So this is the density into area into velocity, okay. Now let me normalize rho t and Vt with respect to chamber conditions. Why? Because I know for a choke flow that it is only dependent on the upstream conditions. Upstream of the throat is the chamber. So if I normalize it with chamber conditions, I will be able to derive some useful equations. rho t and v t. With rho c, which is the density at in the chamber, and a t, which is the acoustic speed or the speed of sound at the throat, so we will get m dot is equal to rho t by rho c into a t into v t l by a t into what is a t? I know that a t is equal to right. So I will normalize this also with the chamber conditions and multiply by under root Tc. What is this ratio? This is the ratio of local speed, fluid speed to acoustic speed, which is nothing but Mach number. Mach number at throat for choke condition is 1. So this is 1. So we get m dot is equal to rho t by rho c into a t So now we need to find this ratio and this ratio. We already know for choke flow what is this ratio, we also know pressure ratio. So density ratio is nothing but rho t by rho c is nothing but pt by r tt into r tc by pc. So r cancels out, you get pt by pc into tc by tt. We have already derived them, that is nothing but into gamma plus 1 by 2, okay. This is the temperature ratio, this is the pressure ratio. So now if we, because these two are the same, we can add the powers and we can simplify it as rho t by rho c, I will get it as I also know TT by TC, which is nothing but I need under root, so this would be minus half. Now I know all the ratios that I wanted, these two, I can substitute them and get the relation for mass flow rate as m dot is equal to I am sorry, you didn't remind me, I needed to multiply by, if I divide this by rho c, I need to multiply by rho c again. So this is rho c into rho t by rho c into this. So, I will get here rho c a t Now I can deal with them because they are same base but different powers. I can add the powers. So I will get and further this minus I can replace it as plus, and this rho c I can write it in terms of pressure. So I will get P c by R T c into A t gamma R T c. Because I have a minus sign here, I can write this as 2 by gamma plus 1 into gamma plus 1. Okay. Now I have RTC here and RTC here, so I can re-simplify all of this and write it as this is very similar to something that you have already derived in gas dynamics, wherein you will not use P c, you will instead use P naught A star by T naught, right. This whole function, this whole thing is a function of only gamma. So normally in rocket literature this is denoted as a gamma of gamma function. So we get m dot is equal to P c A t by C star, where C star is called the characteristic velocity, and C star is given by 1 by gamma of gamma into Ru by m is nothing but R. So C star is given by this, where gamma of gamma is only a function of ratio of specific heats. That is, okay. So this is the typical expression that we use in rockets when we are discussing rockets. For mass flow rate through a choke nozzle, okay. This gamma of gamma is also called as a Vandenkirchhoff function. And varies from point 64 to 0.667 for gamma variation of Now we know how to get the mass flow rate through a choke nozzle. Now, if you recollect back, we had derived expression for the thrust of the rocket motor when we were discussing about the thrust of the turbojet engine, so or an air breathing engine. So we know that rocket engine F is equal to m dot UE plus AE PE minus PA, where E indicates exit conditions A indicates ambient condition. So you have here UE, which is the exit velocity, exit area, exit pressure and ambient pressure, okay. Now we in the thrust equation we already know how to calculate m dot for a choke nozzle. So this part we know. We need to now find out how to get the exit velocity, and then we need to get something about area ratios and other things. We'll look at it a little later. Firstly, let us get an expression for the exit velocity. How do we get this expression? We know that the energy equation is valid from the entry of the nozzle to the exit of the nozzle. So from that we know we can write from energy equation HE plus UE square by 2 is equal to HC. we had seen a little earlier with respect to the throat, this equation. Now we apply it to the exit of the nozzle. Okay, so I can rewrite this as UE is equal to under root 2 HC minus HE. Since we know that there are no reactions that are taking place inside the nozzle and the thermodynamic properties are constant from the entry of the nozzle to the exit of the nozzle, all this must be sensible enthalpy. So therefore we can write this in terms of UE is equal to 2Cp Tc into 1 minus TE by TC, and TE by TC we can express it in terms of pressure as equal to under root 1 by this part CPTC part. I can this is UE CPTC I know is equal to CP by R into RTC. Okay. Now this RTC, what is C star? C star is nothing but RU TC by molecular weight or RTC, right. This is nothing but is equal to 1 by gamma of gamma into under root RTC. So this part here RTC must be equal to C star square gamma square. Okay. So I can put this, what is CP by R? This I can write it as gamma by gamma minus 1 into okay. So if I substitute back this into the expression for UE, I'll get UE is equal to because this has square here and this is in the root, I can take it out and write it like this. Now what this tells us is that if we know the characteristic velocity and the pressure ratio, we can get the exit velocity, right. So if PE goes to 0, what happens? If this will UE will be a maximum when PE goes to 0. So when PE is equal to 0, UE is maximum and is called limiting exhaust velocity. Okay. That is, it will only become a function of the chamber temperature. PE becoming 0 here means, in this case, if PE goes to 0, TE also has to go to 0. So, the UE would this then become under root, that is, it becomes only a function of the chamber temperature. But in reality, we cannot get a condition where in the exit velocity, this is not the ambient velocity, ambient pressure, this is the exit of the nozzle being at 0 pressure. This is not possible, this will be some finite number. So, therefore, you cannot get this condition, but this is the maximum that one can get with a conversion divergent nozzle. Okay. Now we need to also get one more parameter, that is, how does, we still do not know how AE and PE are connected. That is, if we know the area ratio that from the throat to the exit, how does one obtain PE? From, if knowing PC, how can we obtain PE? So, let us do that. So, let us relate PE by PC to AE by AT. To start this, what we know is, we know that mass flow rate, once the nozzle is choked and the flow is steady, the mass flow rate at any cross section is the same and cannot vary. So, we know m dot is equal to PC AT by C star and is also equal to rho E UE AE, okay, where E indicates exit conditions. Okay. So, from this I can get an expression for AE by AT as PC okay. Now I know rho E is nothing but rho E is PE by RTE and if I substitute for that here, I also know the expression for UE which we just derived. Okay. So, if we substitute for both of them here, rho E and UE, we will get an expression for AE by AT. This is the expression that we get once we substitute for UE and rho E. Now here what is again C star into, if we take a gamma of gamma here, so you get C star into gamma of gamma square, which is nothing but R TC, right. So we get PC by PE into RTE divided by RTC, that is we need to have a gamma of gamma in the numerator to account for this. Into 2 gamma by gamma minus 1 I can cancel the R's and TE by TC I can again express in terms of pressures. I already have a PC by PE, so I know that TE by TC is nothing but PE by PC to the power of gamma minus 1 by gamma. So if I substitute for all this, for this here and simplify, or I can, because I can put them together and rewrite this as Now if you notice, this is a relation connecting area ratios to pressure ratios. Mostly we will know what is the geometric area ratio of the nozzle that we are taking, and to get the pressure ratio from knowing the nozzle ratio, nozzle area ratio using this equation is very difficult. So therefore we have gas dynamic tables which will give you this, or there are plots that will tell you how PE by PC varies if you vary AE by AT. Okay, we will look at it in the next class. Thank you.